Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And I'm Kaylee.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast. And today's topic is impressions and character voices. Mm-hmm. So we all love funny voices, whether it's from cartoons or from plays or from movies or video games. We all follow a ton of video games with voice acting. I know, Ryan, you just finished the Borderlands pre-sequel, which I have not done yet.
Yeah,
I stepped away from it for a little bit. I didn't want to go and finish the game until I did some of the side quests, but the side quests were taking me far too long to get from like point A to point B. There's a lot of backtracking that some of the game wasn't set up well for the fast travel points, but it was all right. I mean, I enjoyed it. I didn't enjoy it as much as Borderlands 2, but for what it was good. If you like Borderlands 2, you probably will like this one. So
nice. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's a ton of fun voice acting in there.
There is a lot of great voice acting in there.
The moon is just Australia.
I love that the moon is Australia. Because it was made in Australia. The game was made in Australia. So this is like, F it. Everyone on the moon is Australian, except for the people that we already have established voices for.
Yeah. Don't ask questions.
Moon zoomie.
Drive around in moon zoomies.
My Australian accent is terrible.
The Aztecs.
Yeah, I love that. We call them Oz kids.
No reason.
Well, didn't they say it was because on the first printing, the O and the 2 were too close together, so it looked like Oz instead of O2 kids?
Sure, whatever.
I have no idea.
Point being, character voices, cartoons, accents, things like that. Icebreaker. What is your favorite character voice? I mean, whether it's from a video game, or like a particular voice actor, or from a movie, or whatever.
Okay, it's good you said voice actor, because my choice was James Earl Jones.
Ooh.
Not just for his work as Darth Vader, but just whenever he's
Mufasa.
Or Mufasa.
The light touches.
His voice is always commanding. And really inspirational that he started off with a really bad speech impediment and he overcame that in order to become an actor.
I think he
had a really bad stutter or something like that that he had to overcome. But I think of him like in The Sandlot or in The Hunt for Red October.
Yeah.
You know, he always, when he's on stage or on camera, his voice is just powerful. It's just intense. And so I'd say he's probably one of my favorites.
I'm reminded of And I feel like James Earl Jones is the same way. I forget the name of the guy who does the voice for Optimus Prime.
Frank Welker?
Yeah,
or is it Peter Cullen? Because they're both on there. One does Megatron, one does...
I think Peter Cullen does Megatron, but no, I'm wrong. Peter Cullen is Optimus Prime.
Okay.
But I remember reading a thing online at some point. I'll see if I can dig it up for the show notes. It was a long time ago where it was just like an answering machine message that he had left for his son's principal. And because Optimus Prime isn't like an impression that he puts on, it's just his regular voice with a bit of distortion.
Yeah.
And so, like, it's like you get a a message from a disgruntled parent that is Optimus Prime. And I feel like James Earl Jones is the same sort of thing. Kids, go to your room. No, Dad, did you hear my voice? Go to my room.
I use the Optimus voice, or the Optimist voice, I'm using air quotes there, whatever. I give a lot of people rides home from the bar, like my co-workers, and so usually that's how I signal I'm ready to go, is I'll stand up and I'll be like, Autobots, roll out! They just all get up and follow me out of the bar.
That's wonderful.
Kaylee, favorite voice actor,
I've been sitting here thinking about this really intensely, and I have several that I keep thinking of, but they're... I don't know that they're my favorite ever. They're like my favorite.
Well, it's fine.
Okay, my favorite right now, at this moment, is a really kind of creepy one. It's, I've lost his name. Jeremy Irons.
Jeremy Irons
is one of my favorite voices in anywhere. He has a wonderful voice. But the thing that made me realize that he has a really, really cool voice and is a really kind of great actor...
Die Hard 3?
No, worse. Much worse.
Dungeons and Dragons movie.
No, it's not actually worse. It's I listened to him read the audiobook of Lolita.
Oh yeah.
Which in combination with just the word choices and the really, really evocative writing, his voice doing it is so good. It's really, really, I don't have another word, evocative.
Okay. No, that's legit.
And he's got a really, just a great voice to listen to. And also, he was in The Lion King.
Which, funny enough.
Oh, was he with Scar in The Lion King?
Scar.
Oh,
and
man.
Funny enough.
We did not collude in this in any way.
No, but here's another level of interesting. So, either he was sick or something and he couldn't do the singing part for Scar. Guess who they got to come in and do the singing part? Frank Welker. Frank Welker comes in, and so there, you can hear, there's only a little bit of a connection there where you can tell where it changes a little mm-hmm. bit, but otherwise he came in. He did the same thing in Anastasia for Christopher Lloyd,
his part,
when he's singing Hell. Same thing. He came in and pretty much mimicked the voice on cue.
That guy.
That's amazing.
That guy is like the villain singing voice in cartoons.
Yeah. Man. I also like that we both chose people who have been like villains and whatnot, so... Very, very good. So, Jim, you got a tall order.
I assume that I also have to pick someone who's been in The Lion King, so I could just pick, like, Nathan Lane or something. But
it's a pretty good voice.
He's the only other person I can remember from The Lion King. I've never seen The Lion King.
Well, you had the kid.
I don't have any.
Jonathan Taylor Thomas was young Simba.
Yeah. But no, I had to think a bunch about this because I really love the voice acting in Dragon Ball Z Abridged.
Okay.
It's just I like that it's super varied. I love the different voice affectations they do. Like that's what sort of really nails it for me in terms of like cartoon and character voices as opposed to just like adopting different accents.
Mm.
Like every voice has a distinct character, whether it's like Vegeta who just yells all the time mm-hmm. and is a complete megalomaniac, or Goku who doesn't understand anything and he just sort of says this, okay, all right, you know, sort of thing, or Piccolo who has no friends and hates everyone. I don't know, everybody's got sort of a different, like it is a cartoon where the voices embody the characters for me.
Mm-hmm.
But if I had to pick favorite, it's really, really, really stupid. It is Clinton Boomer doing Invisible Christopher Walken. So, and I will put a link to this in the show notes because it's hilarious. These guys, they haven't done this for years. I ran across this like maybe 5 or 6 years ago, but it was Clinton Boomer and another guy and a bunch of their friends, and they did the D&D PSAs. So they just pretended to be characters from the Dungeons and Dragons handbooks doing public service announcements.
Oh dear.
So Rhaegdar the fighter, who's just like, let me tell you why fighter is the best class. Watch this. First level, human, fighter, second level, third level, fills the hand. He's like, you get more feats than anybody. What else do you need? You got a feat for everything. But, you know, they had Clinton Boomer played Hennet the Sorcerer, who in the book is depicted as wearing belts from, like, his knees up to his nipples. So he's just, like, he's just wearing belts as a shirt. Like, it's just, the comedy's really funny. There's a lot of really cool stuff in there. They did, like, 50 or 60 episodes.
Really?
Over the course of 2 or 3 years. Yeah, it was awesome. Now they're doing all kinds of other stuff. They were creative juices, and they were one of the first sort of comedy troupes I got into online. But one of their characters, in like it's episode 6 or so, they introduced the most powerful monster in the Monster Manual. So powerful that you weren't even authorized to see the page he was on. It was Invisible Christopher Walken. And the best part about it was not that like Boomer's Christopher Walken impression taught me how to do my Christopher Walken impression. My Christopher Walken is just an impression of him doing that impression.
I feel like most Christopher Walken impressions are an impression of somebody else
doing a Christopher Walken impression. Yeah, probably. But it is that they would repeatedly in their like Q&As and podcasts, and they would thank Christopher Walken and be like, yeah, you know, working with Christopher Walken is so great. He is such a cool guy. I mean, he's really sort of unassuming. We did have to get him the special, the green suit, so that we could green screen him out of every shot so he could be invisible Christopher Walken. Like, they just own it. It's hilarious. And, like they never credit Boomer as the voice of Christopher Walken. They just credit Christopher Walken.
Awesome.
It's pretty funny.
Well, I guess if you do a good job, that's the highest compliment you could be
paid. It's not a great Christopher Walken impression.
Oh, is it not?
It isn't.
The funny part is that it's really obvious.
No, it's just average. I mean, you know it's not Christopher Walken because it's not Christopher Walken.
Right.
Well, in that case, I'm looking forward to watching the video to check this
out. It's going to be a good time. Yeah, I will send it to you guys. It will be in the show notes so you guys can watch it along with Dragon Ball Z Abridged. Because you clearly didn't have enough stuff to watch online.
No.
But yeah, impressions and voices and character voices, I think, are all sort of different things.
True.
My street cred with impressions is generally I spend a lot of time thinking about how people make sounds. I spent a lot of time studying languages and linguistics in school. So I've studied about 5 or 6 languages, and as well as linguistics itself. So, I mean, for me, it's all about sort of timbre and face shape and breathing and posture. Posture is a really big one for getting different voices. And I practice that every couple of weeks at D&D, which is basically my excuse to talk in funny voices for 4 hours.
And boy does he.
Oh yeah. Also at work, but less.
It's less accepted.
I don't know that that's true. I feel like there's a point where you're just like, yep, I'm a scorch that bug ticket. People are fine with it.
Yeah. It's probably true.
But Ryan, where do you talk in funny voices? What do you do with your funny voices?
I do a little bit of D&D, although anybody who's played D&D with me will admit that I'm a terrible role player. So I'll start with a voice to kind of give...
No judgment here, sir.
Well, no. I'm just saying, like, I'll start with a voice in order to kind of give shape to the character, but then a lot of times I'll switch back to my natural speaking voice so I don't get hung up on trying to get it right. I'll just go back to it. As a kid, I wanted to be a voice actor, and I always joked around that if philosophy didn't work out, I'd go and join voice acting. And then I've done like little bits of imitations here and there. Particularly, the big one for me was karaoke, because I'm pretty adamant that I'm not actually a good singer. I'm just really good at mimicking certain bands, certain styles. I stick pretty hardcore within my range. I don't really go above or below that. If I had a little bit more training, maybe I'd feel a little more comfortable with that. But otherwise, I just mimic Pearl Jam, mimic Red Hot Chili Peppers. And then, I guess the other one that I usually, it's at the bar, but not karaoke. So when I'm on a security shift, I'll walk by people and I'll just say weird things, you know, like, I am justice. And just imagine, me walking by them in a busy crowd, just be like, I am the
For
knight.
For those of you who have only ever listened to the podcast, Huck is a very large man.
I am a very large man.
I feel like I would be really intimidated if you walked by me in a bar, in a crowd, and just went, I am the knight.
Yeah, like, that would be, like, I mean, you've got your, like, security shirt on, and you're with your name tag and stuff like that. So, like, you're not just, like, some jerk in a bar doing it.
Yeah.
But it's still a little... I mean, I guess it's probably better for this whole security gig than, like, wandering up to someone and being like, oh, Pip-Pip! Hello! Are you having a good time?
I fight Grand. For the oppressed. I fight for justice.
Yes, that!
Hey, what?
So, I'll do stuff like that, or after the bar, I'll make goofy, nerdy, you know, trying to... Hey, guys, you know, how's it going? You know, it's just, puberty's great. I just hit it. I got a ton of bricks.
Oh, man. You
know, I'll just do really weird stuff like that to my coworkers.
Puberty coming to a huckle near you.
Yeah. Well, and part of the thing with the bar or any of those kinds of jobs where you work in a team and it's you have to really rely on each other is you make each other laugh and work really hard to cheer each other up when things go crappy. So, you know, that's kind of my experience right now of what I'm doing with it. Never really got around to voice acting proper, but who knows? Maybe if this philosophy thing doesn't work out.
Can we start the Wootsuit animated series?
Puppets.
Puppets, yes.
Yeah, it'll be a thing.
Kaylee and I really want to do some videos with puppets.
Really?
Then we'll have puppets. To start writing videos with puppets.
It'll be great.
Yes.
Anyway. I am the puppet master.
Of what? You're doing a puppet hand when you do that. You are, by definition, not the puppet master. Unless your puppet is, in fact, holding the strings of a smaller puppet.
Your hand could which be a puppet.
Which is totally a thing that... Yeah, but it's not the puppet master.
Oh, I see. I understand.
Unless it is not the master of puppets, unless it, in fact, controls puppets. Unless it's like, I am the puppet which is named the master of puppets.
My hand puppet controls other puppets by telepathy.
My hand puppet tells them what to do. You!
Who's to say that the puppet's not controlling me and I'm just, like, it's really bad at lip syncing?
That's legit, man. How do you know? You don't know.
Oh my god, he was a hand this whole time.
He was very uncomfortable playing the bass a couple episodes ago.
Oh god. Anyway, Kaylee, funny voices.
I just think they're neat. I don't have any cred. I don't have any experience. I just like them. I pay attention to things like accents and the way people make their sounds, and I just find it very, very interesting. And I spend a lot of time, this is gonna sound a little sad, but like a lot of time when I am by myself just kind of making sounds.
Now, I understand that when you say that, you mean talking in funny voices about things, which mm-hmm. I do too, but yeah. There's a part of me for a moment there that was just like whale song.
Ooh.
Or I'm right.
No, this cannot become the whale podcast. I bet there are podcasts for that. This is not...
All right.
Somebody out there in our audience is like, they got it so wrong.
Next.
That is just terrible. I'm going to write it in the comments next and
season,
let them know.
No, next season, Whale Song Podcast.
Great.
We'll bring in Charlotte.
Yeah, that's actually not a bad idea. Yeah.
Full of good ideas tonight. But no, one of the things we were talking about with voices and characters is the notion of doing it right. I spend a lot of time, I mean, at D&D, I don't have a lot of sort of character voices or cartoon voices. That's why I like, cartoons so much, is because, often, all of these characters, I don't know why the only cartoon I can think of off the top of my head is the Gummy Bears, but, I mean, it's a perfectly good example.
That old kick-ass theme song.
Gummy Bears, friends and people. No, okay.
It's fine. But... it is that notion that each of these characters is embodied by their voice and by their art. And in D&D, I am just me, and I have to play usually, I don't know, like 8 or 10 characters over the course of a game. Whereas as these jokers are walking around interrogating everybody and sciencing stuff, and they science the crap out of everything.
Yeah, it's true. For science.
Yeah. You know, and they're... they're having eventful evenings with all kinds of messenger deliveries and things like that. And the result is that I can't change what I look like. I can't just spontaneously grow a mustache.
Although if you could.
Depends on how you... For those of you who are only listening to this, I have just grown a mustache.
He's lying.
I'm lying.
It depends on how you define instant, like spontaneously versus instantaneously, because like... your face spontaneously does grow facial.
I really don't feel like that was his point.
Yes, thank you.
Just throwing that out there.
It's not spontaneous at all. It's sort of at a
systematic.
Yeah, it's sort of, there's you know strict causal rules applying to it. But
surprise.
And I don't keep a lot of just like costume implements around, partly because I get embarrassed with costume implements.
Mm.
And partly because they're uncomfortable. Often there's a guy in town who GMs games in like a full like robe with a mask.
That sounds really creepy, actually.
He does it like the Adventurers Guild, which is one of our local board gaming bars.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, seriously, in the context where I started playing D&D with you, that is to say, hey, strange man on the internet, I'm going to come to your apartment and play D&D.
That's true.
That would be scary as heck.
Yes. Also, we don't do a series, like, our game is serious, but it's also kind of a comedy game.
And that's
the way we like it. So, but I don't have a lot of, like, props to use. and they don't come firsthand. So I have to do it with mannerisms, and I have to try and embody that character and embody their voice and make them meaningfully different, not just with the story that they have that often the players pay absolutely no attention to.
That's not true. I mean, it's a little true.
But also, yeah. Who's the guy we met in the curse bar? He was the cursed guy in the curse bar.
You know, the guy with the curse.
Yes, thank you.
He had a Russian accent, just like everyone else.
Yeah. His name was Victor, with a K. All
right.
Wouldn't it be Victor?
No. He had a Ukrainian accent.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. But
I don't pay any attention.
Part of it is but no, like part of it is I try and it is easiest for me to embody those characters with accents rather than like cartoony voices. So if you're Russian, you get the front of the the front of the mouth voice or the back of the mouth voice, depending on where you're from, and depending on what I feel like, and depending on sort of what I feel fits right for that character. And a lot of it is just voices I've borrowed from TV or customers or like random things over the past 20 years. That I'm like, I remember this voice, and this is how they talk, and this is the shape that they make with their mouth, and that determines the shape I make with my body. It's a whole thing. But I think the bit I miss out on is all the cool cartoony stuff.
Yeah.
Partly because I don't just want to yell all the time like Vegeta. Like, nobody wants to put up with cartoony voice for like an hour.
That's true. I feel like the closest thing that you've got to like a cartoon or a caricature voice is your mansplainer voice.
Listen, I just need to explain a few things to you about let me explain patriarchy.
More cheeks.
Let me explain patriarchy. Right? And we'll go down to where what would be the brass tacks of it about why you're wrong about it. Yeah, no, I have a lot of like super, but
listen. You can't just explain the patriarchy.
Oh my god.
I'm doing impressions of Jim's impressions.
No, you just tried to mansplain my mansplaining voice that was mansplaining you. We have now reached metasplaining.
Now listen here, guys. The one you can do with the best is Droopy Dog. He's the...
Droopy Dog? All right. I don't have enough cheeks.
It's too much when you do it this way. You gotta do it just for fun, because it opens up the cheek a little bit, so...
I can't do that.
Yes, you can. You just have to practice. Let me explain it to you, okay, honey?
Jesus. This is the voice and impressions podcast. We're super problematic. Oh, my God. But...
You should smile more.
Jesus. I will kill you.
I got that at the bar, actually. Some, I don't know if it was his birthday, but his mom was there because he made a point of explaining, I don't know, the guy was 35 or older or whatever, and he made a point of explaining his mom getting a blowjob shot from the bar or whatever, and then she gave it to him. Anyways, she came up to me,
a blowjob shot at the bar.
Anyways, she came up to me while I was standing, on the washroom post that night, and she came up to me, and she didn't say, you should smile because you look pretty kind of deal, but she's like, don't you ever smile? And of course, I had to smile at that, right? But it was just, I sat there, I'm just like, man, I just got that question, like, not got it, understood it, but I just received that question. That was so weird. Normally, yeah.
Also, not evidence of patriarchy.
No, it's not. It's just that was the first time that it's ever come at me. But you know, so I was on a security shift and I was inside. I think probably
no man
journeys
looking,
don't stop leaving.
Looking dour is my job.
Yeah,
I'm a Stark.
Wiener, floppy wiener. You don't watch South Park, so you don't get that.
Yeah,
when they made fun of...
I don't know what you're talking about.
They made fun of... They did a three-part...
I don't know what you just did, but it's immortalized forever on YouTube now.
They already did it. Butters, I know you don't watch it, but they did a three-part thing that combined Game of Thrones with Black Friday sales. And then there's a side thing where Butters is like, why is all the... It's just everywhere in the Game of Thrones books. It's just floppy wieners everywhere. Like, what is George R.R. Martin? So he goes to meet George R.R. Martin and ask about it. And Martin seems to be really... has a fascination with like writing wieners into the books. Anyways,
okay.
If I know you're not into South Park, it's not funny to you. But when they took the Game of Thrones song and turned it into a song about floppy wieners, it was kind of humorous to me.
Screw you guys, I'm going home.
To be fair, I did turn the Skyrim song into a song about bread.
That's a
video.
I guess that's fair, but I was expecting something else to come out of that.
Trust me, it's going to be great.
Okay.
But, yeah. Accents and character voices and cartoon voices. Mm-hmm. That is, I think you're right. The other thing is that nobody wants to put up with cartoon voice for a freaking hour.
Yeah, if you did the mansplainer voice for like an hour, I would just
freak out. I did the mansplainer voice once for 20 minutes when we were playing Secret World. And after 20 minutes, everyone wanted to quit. Like, they're just like, Jim, you need to stop doing that voice.
It's because it is the most annoying voice you can
and
imagine.
And I stopped. But it is like, even like, I'm trying to think of like a cool cartoon voice. But at the same time, the cool cartoon voice is the cartoon voice that tries to sound cool. I have the hardest time with, and this is the voice of my D&D character currently, is just sounding like an actual adult male.
Mm.
And not talking like Batman.
My favorite adult male cool voice is probably Archer.
Mm.
And it's got a very, that's Benjamin, a very, yeah, H. Benjamin.
John H.
John, yeah. Or J. H. H. John Benjamin.
Anyway. Yeah, yeah,
Mr. Benjamin. he does a very good, like, testosterone-filled but not meat-headed adult male.
I don't know, he sounds kind of meat-headed.
No, meat-headed, he's not, like, jockey kind
right.
of.
He's
like,
not, he doesn't sound like a huge dude.
Yeah,
I actually have no idea what
dense.
The guy looks like.
Yeah.
Well, I only know his characters.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and that's really what you want, I think, in a lot of those cases, is you want to get to know the characters. I mean, that's also how, if like there's a lot of really great voice actors who do 3 or 4 characters on a show, or more.
Mm-hmm.
Hank Azaria.
Well, I remember the beginning of The Simpsons, when The Simpsons was like 5 people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the whole show.
Was Hank Azaria?
No, there were a couple other people, but it was like Hank Azaria and 3 women. Yeah, I remember being 10 and being like, Bart Simpson is a lady. And that lady is like 10 other voices on the show.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And there's, was it Yeardley Smith? Yeardley Smith, who only does the one, Lisa Simpson.
Mm.
She got lucky.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Goes in, does her part, gets out, doesn't have to do 50 parts.
I think the definitive voice actor for me is always Mark Hamill.
Yeah.
As the Joker. I mean, that was the, like he became that role. Like, when people think of the animated Joker,
they are thinking of the Mark Hamill voice.
Yeah,
for sure.
and like he just retired from it, like, mm-hmm. last year, I think, or 2 years ago. And so now there's somebody new, and I've seen some of the new videos,
mm-hmm.
With the Joker, because I'm a super nerd.
Sure.
And I download Justice League movies.
Yeah.
But, and he's really good. It's a totally different take on the character. But it had to be. Like, it had to be. That I think is the really cool thing about just nailing a character, and that is sort of what I'm always trying for, is that idea of epitomizing them and becoming them, and especially with a character, it's got to be really hard to do it with a character that's already established or already, like, the advantage of D&D is I get to make everybody up and you guys meet them for the first time when I introduce you.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, we're gonna go to the tower and see the wizard guy. I'm like, all right, the wizard guy. Let me check my notes. The wizard guy has a bunch of things. He lives in the tower. He's gay. He loves chemistry, and he plays the lute. Sweet. And he opens the door, and you're like, bow, sup. And you're like, how does he make that sound on a lute? He's like, bow, I'm a wizard.
Like, my favorite wizard from our campaign was, his name escapes me off the top because he was in the last campaign.
See?
But
nobody pays attention.
No, it's not that. It's just, it's not the name. It's because he was basically Tommy Chong, who, hey, man, you got any red weed, man? Because, like, I need to do some experiments, man, with red weed. And we would barter, like, my character, when I died, and they resurrected me, and I accidentally rolled a male dwarf.
Accidentally.
So I went from human to dwarf. And it's like, hey, man, like, yeah, it sometimes works, man, but, like, I'll take my payment of red weed, man. Oh, by the way, Dave's not here, man.
Oh, man. I used to do celebrity impressions a lot for that kind of thing, but I find that, and I think this is true of all sort of instances of celebrity impressions. Like, you look at, I mean, we talked, in the pre-show, we talked about McBain,
mm-hmm.
from Simpsons,
yes.
who is just sort of
the caricature of Arnold Schwarzenegger in every action movie.
Yeah.
No.
And... you get sort of, it's easy to get caught up in the celebrity, or the character becomes the Tommy Chong guy,
yeah.
rather than, you know, that way. Like,
that's a perfect example. He forgot his name because he was the wizard that was like Tommy Chong.
Yeah, and that is exactly what I sort of don't want, because it hurts my pride and my soul.
The other thing that makes, I think, just sort of as an observation, why you wouldn't want to do cartoon voices for your characters in D&D in that kind of setting is because when you, like, the cartoon voices tend to have to be way more animated and much more emphatic, and your voice has to be all over the place, up and down, and very, very, like, much more fluid. I'm making, like, a wavy mm-hmm. hand motion.
Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely adds to the sentence.
Well, it is exhausting, yeah.
It would be a lot more work
to
do
it. It is a lot more work.
As opposed to just sounding like
I already drank, like, 3 liters of water during D&D.
Right.
Like,
Jim, why are you sweating so much?
No, it's Jim. Why did you spend half the session in the washroom? I'm planning.
But I feel like having that much dynamicism to your voices, as opposed to just sounding like, you know, a person speaking in the way that they speak, whereas cartoons tend to exaggerate all their mannerisms and that kind of thing vocally as well. So creating cartoony voices for your characters would be more complicated in like a 3 and 4 hour setting.
Yeah, I mean, it still seems really fun, but I think you're right that I mean, the advantage of doing it as a voice actor is you get to sort of take breaks and you have a lot of practicing, and as a GM, you've got to sort of make it all up on the fly, because mm-hmm. you never know when your players are going to ask something like,
what about that guy over there?
Yeah, and you're like, oh, that guy, he is... Clatter some dice, think about a thing, look, stall, look around, flip through some paper, pretend like you're checking your notes, be like, oh, I left that on the wiki, yeah, I'll just look on the wiki, click an in-generator... generator character. His name is Hraldi, and he's a dwarf centaur with luck magic.
Except the thing is, Jim did just pull that out of his brain, so it's not even...
And then you're like, his name is Hraldi, and he's a dwarf centaur with luck manipulation powers. What does he talk like? His name is Hraldi. He talks like...
a Swede?
No, he talks like... Ulfric Stormcloak from Skyrim, and you're
so
like... sup, Hraldi, and he's like, hello... I am Ulfric. I mean, Hraldi. What was my name again? Check the in generator thing. Look it up again. Be like, oh, Dwarf Centaur, right. Clop, clop, Hraldi. How are you?
Are you sure that the Swede thing was not where you were going?
Maybe. I don't know. Like, that's the thing is, I especially voices that I steal from other stuff.
Yeah, you don't know.
I can't really figure out the ethnicity of it or anything like that, and I'm just like, it is the voice of this character from this thing.
Mm-hmm. Like, that's the thing. A lot of the accents that I do know and can identify, it's because I associate them with a specific person. Like, I know, I said this in the pre-show, my go-to reference point for a Dublin accent is Chris O'Dowd. He's like, anybody that I hear speaking with a Dublin accent, I hear them and I say, oh, that person talks like Chris O'Dowd. That means they're probably from Dublin. And I have a bunch of those just sort of mentally filed away that this person sounds like that person.
Especially turning it off and on again.
Yeah.
Yes.
You should use that at work.
What?
Have you tried turning it off and on again?
Yeah.
We had a conversation at work about how everything in any level of tech support, be it like the top... most complicated level of IT, is just escalating levels of turning stuff off and on again.
Mm-hmm.
Try logging in, logging back, or logging out, logging back in.
What is it? Oh, the cron doesn't seem to be running. Oh, let's try turning it off and turning it back on again.
Yeah.
Well, what's wrong with this server? We don't know yet. Let's try turning it off and turning it back on again.
Yep.
That is true. Tech support podcast is a different podcast.
Yes.
We'll do that with a bunch of people.
Mm-hmm. Be a big podcast.
It would be a big podcast. Be a good time, though.
Or you could just turn it off and on and make it simple. Hey-o!
Get out.
Oh.
Get out! I feel like that is the other problem with cartoon voices.
Mm.
Especially in contexts like, D&D or plays or things like that. Plays, I think it's a little easier because you do have a script, but it's the shifting of moods
mm-hmm.
is really hard. I think that if, like, experienced voice actors, I think, don't have a problem with that because they are really good at it and they are pros. but in the sense that it is really hard when the mood shifts from happiness to grief.
Hmm.
How do you shift your voice? And that is I think a regular human being question too.
Yes.
But as a human being, you know, or if you go from being really happy to really angry.
That's really just generally hard on a human being.
Mm-hmm. And so it is even harder, I think, when you are...
To fake it?
Yeah. Pretending to be someone else.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, are you the kind of person who... And I often have these as character notes so I can call... Because the other thing is that I have to be able to recall this voice when sometimes, literally 2 years later, somebody's like, why don't we go talk to that guy? I'm like, sure.
The jam-eating dragon.
The jam-eating dragon. Her name is Olivia.
I don't know anybody's name.
They named her. You weren't there, but they named her. Mm. She loves jam.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, like, why don't we go talk to this person that we talked to one time two years ago?
Yeah, they might know about a thing.
They might know about this thing. Or if, for example, in the live stream about a month ago, I reintroduced a character. I don't know why I was about to say reintroduced, because that's not how you say that word.
Emphasis, it's fine.
Yeah. I reintroduced a character that they hadn't interacted with in 2 years.
Mm.
They're doing this sort of whole thing where they're coming full circle in what's going on. And they started out rescuing slaves, and now they're going to not only rescue slaves, but possibly rescue a whole bunch of slavers from a terrible fate. Which will help them participate in this sort of ongoing incoming war. But, I mean, the character who was their contact, when I had to reintroduce her, and I had to remember who she was and what her voice is like, and sort of, she's this moody, brutally efficient spy who now has no one to work for because her employers have been assassinated. And she thinks they're idiots. But they are powerful and useful idiots. And if she can point them in the right direction, they will do powerful and useful things. But she still thinks they're idiots.
Mm-hmm.
And and she's not tactful, so she makes that quite clear. She's not that kind of spy.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm like, I sort of did it on the spur of the moment, because they were looking into a bunch of other things. And I went, okay, yeah, that's a thing that's happening. Okay, how does that react? I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah. Who was that again? What's she like? That, I think, is the other big problem that I face and that I find when talking funny is cross-gender voices.
Mm. I find most of the time when you are doing feminine voices, you just get sort of quieter.
Mm-hmm.
Or deliberately strong.
Mm-hmm.
But that's for a different type of character. But yep. Most of the time, your feminine voices are just your regular voice, only a little whisperier.
Mm-hmm. That's because I can't... If I try and pitch my voice up, it just sounds stupid.
Mm. Yeah, so if you just get whispery...
Yeah, like if I can make it softer, then it's sort of, I think, more apparent. But yeah, I mean, if I just pitch my voice, I'm like, I'm the princess! And welcome to the castle!
Okay, yeah, that's point made.
You're like, we go and see the wizard, and I look up the wizard, and I'm like, oh, the wizard is... her name is Hralda... And she's a dwarf centaur with luck manipulation powers. I'm not as original as you seem to think I am. And you open the door and she's like, "Bow, hello!
I'm Mrs. Doubtfire."
Yeah, I mean, that's really not what you're like. And it's funny to have a Mrs. Doubtfire character, but the downside of it is Robin Williams, who we talked extensively about in the pre-show, has created all, like, his voices do create characters.
Mm-hmm.
And he has created these characters that are so powerful in our culture that there is no room to do anything with that voice anymore. If you open it and you're like, "Hello!" Then everyone's like, "Oh, it's the Mrs. Doubtfire voice." And you're like, "Shit! Welp, I guess I blew this one! I'll just leave it behind!"
Like, the only other person that does that voice really well is, that's Jon Stewart's Queen voice, Queen Mother.
Yes!
"Hello!"
But that, like, he is doing a Mrs. Doubtfire impression when he does that.
Yeah, probably.
I mean, as elderly British lady. And there's that notion where you're just like, so the next time they come and see that wizard, and you're like, well, I guess I better abandon that voice. They're like, we're going to go see the, unless they're like, we're going to go see the Mrs. Doubtfire wizard.
Which invariably they will.
You're like, damn! As, you know, I mean, the next time they show up and you're like, sup. And they're like, didn't you talk like Mrs. Doubtfire before? Yeah, magic. I had a bad
wizard,
day.
Wizard bullshit.
Yeah, wizard bullshit. Wizard, that is...
Wizard's cold.
Oh, man. Wizard's cold are now a thing.
Yeah.
That's canon.
Yep.
But yeah, I know, like feminine voices or cross-gender voices, monster voices I find really hard. I only have about 3 monster voices that don't just destroy my vocal cords.
Is one of them Batman?
No, actually, Batman's a super boring monster voice.
Yeah, a little bit.
Oh, you gotta get the claw.
Hello, mortal.
I can't do it.
Know this. Only one may enter.
Yeah, like, it's just because like, it's so gravelly and it's always some kind of,
yeah,
like,
that one
extended
hurts.
Conversation. And it's really cool for, like, for one-liners. Mm. We're like,
greetings.
Which, that was a really terrible one. But then they're like, okay, explain your plan.
Okay, listen. This is how shit's going down. All right, first, we get the little ones.
That sounds like it's hurting.
Yeah, like, it's just, it gets really bad. Or the one where you, like, inhale and speak.
Yeah, you just...
Like the sort of spectral, like it's...
The ring wraith sound.
Yeah.
I can do that really well, but it's really unpleasant. I'm not going to on the recording.
That was some kind of ghost horse. I am going to have nightmares about that.
A nightmare.
I'm not going
to
do it.
All right, that seems fine. But yeah, like I find that in order to make monsters and voice them, I either have to like really pick one. And part of it is, I think that all the races in my campaign setting are sort of pseudo mapped to some kind of real world geographical location. So all of the goblins are Russian, and half of the goblins have this socialist republic because they are very small and they're used to being pushed around. So they have united with a bunch of other larger races.
Our goblins are petite with the kind of voice, yeah, and no, they take pride in like really terrible goblin craftsmanship. But it's like for us, it's like this, it's a crappy table. It's like, that's a mastercraft.
No, goblins, as far as they're concerned, they are the greatest race in existence. And
well, so why aren't you just making them American?
Because it's not funny.
I don't know.
She's a little funny.
He's a little funny.
But maybe we'll retcon it. I'll think about it. But like, the ogres, on the other hand, ogres all sound like soccer hooligans. Like, they sound like Warhammer 40k orcs.
See, the ogres for me have been ruined from Warcraft 2. Just like...
Oh, yeah.
With the two-headed, especially like when they're... He did it. No, he did it.
This way. No, that way. Yeah, and you get into that kind of stuff. But again, it's... Like, Warcraft and video games and things like that are great places to pick up voices and learn, and there's all kinds of, like, really cool sound bites you get in there. But as soon as you have, like, you know, the trick is taking that and turning it into an extended conversation.
Yes. Mm. It's all well and good to be like, ready to work, but try and do that for, like, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Zabza.
Please describe your workflow, peon. Okay, first we get the little ones, then we get the big ones, then we get the bigger ones. We stack the little ones on the big ones, and then we stack the bigger ones on the little ones. And then we have
See,
this sort of...
You lost your gravel, too.
Yeah, I know, I totally do. Yeah, it's voice. Just like, it's just, oh.
The hard part is
you end up sounding like Ernie from Sesame Street.
Yes, a bit.
But, yeah, it's neat to steal video voices from there, but for anything past the one-liner, I mean, for two-headed... ogres, you always have to have one smart head and one stupid head. Otherwise,
it's just in the rules.
Well, no, it's because it's boring. If you have two stupid heads, you can't have a meaningful conversation. You just have, it's like talking to an idiot. Only there's two of them. You're like, hey, Etten. Ettens are two-headed giants in D&D. What are you doing here? I'm an idiot. I'm also an idiot. You're like, explain yourself. Fight me. Fight him.
I think that's the smart one. Like, we just determined.
No,
is that your soccer hooligan?
No, no, no. Oh God, no.
Because it sounded like it could.
Oh,
be.
Oh God, no. We get way deeper into that one, but that'll blow our levels. No, but yeah, and you can't have two smart heads because then you just have two smart heads. It's like it's so ridiculous. They will either continually argue with each other because they are smart, or they will just outsmart your party because they are not only super strong because they're giants, they're also smart. So it's like, Oh, we've found you. Yes, Reginald, they seem to have found us. What a terrible predicament. Oh, yes, Harold, if only we hadn't planned for this. Why are you all British? Shut up. Pay attention to the trap.
What trap?
This trap. Ah! 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 Ah!
So Ettins pose a unique problem in D&D.
Just one smart head, one stupid head.
What I'm trying to say is we got derailed.
Yes.
But I don't remember from where.
from taking voices from games.
Yes.
And pulling those out into characters that aren't those characters. I mean, there's you talked about Borderlands pre-sequel.
Mm-hmm.
And there's tons of cool voice acting in there. I mean, you've got Moxie, you've got Chaney. You've got Moxie, they introduced this really neat shift. Moxie is the sort of I don't want to say femme fatale, that's the wrong archetype for her. She's sort of this strongly feminine, seductress sort of vibe.
For context, her name has, like, Moxie, M-O-X-X-X-I.
Yes.
That sort of sums it up.
Well, we'll have a link and a picture of Moxie in the show notes, don't worry about that. But, There's this moment where she breaks character in the game.
And she's from the South,
she's from the South, and her kids, who you meet over the course of Borderlands...
all have that Southern, I'm gonna fix a car,
catch a ride! And accent, and she's like, what are y'all doing back here? And she's like, oh, I don't normally let people see me out of character. And
so the implication is this: the character that you have known all and loved as Moxie all along through two whole games, is not really Moxie at all. Which, I mean, it never occurred to me to wonder why her children have Southern accents until then.
Yeah, and it's this persona that she adopts. I mean, there's lots of cool stuff. Mr. Torg is in it.
Yep.
Mr. Torg Flexington.
High five Flexington.
Thank you. I missed out on his middle name.
I love that, especially when he started talking about not friend zoning.
The friend zoning thing when he talks about how he got friend zoned, and then he butts in a meta commentary after the fact, and it's like, hey, are you talking about that time when I started talking about friend zoning? I've since then learned that it's a construct of the patriarchy, and it's really sort of bullshit. It's really neat.
I like the character voice for Mr. Torg because it's just a guy yelling the time.
Yeah, he just yells all the time.
It feels like he should have a guitar in his hand at all times. Because
sometimes there are random guitar solos, or sometimes he sings the guitar solos, so he's just talking. He'll be like, and then some stuff blew up! Mean guitar solo! Meanly, 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 mean!
Oh man, I haven't had that happen. That sounds awesome.
It definitely happens.
But yeah, so there's a whole... like the thing with those voices, like, you can borrow those voices, but in the same way that you know, voices from Robin Williams characters or celebrity impressions, like, if your players know them, they are that character.
Mm-hmm.
And that character is so strong that it invades your space and takes over whatever character you're trying to present. Whether you're trying to do a character, you know, in a play, or, you know, for D&D, or in an animation, or in a puppet, or whatever, you are trying to inhabit a character, and it is hard to do when you have that other character sort of horning in on your action.
There's this whole conversation makes me think of a comedian that I saw, not in person, but I have seen her bits,
mm-hmm.
where her whole sketch, she's a ventriloquist.
Sweet.
And she puts, she calls up somebody from the audience, puts a mask on them that has a big floppy mouth that she controls with a button.
Nice.
And she then will talk as the person, and she has like a silly, goofy, girly mask and has a, I'm so funny! And has that high, squeaky voice, but her regular voice is similar range-wise to mine, kind of low, and has that, I forget what type of accent, some flavor of British. And she has a man mask, and she's got the big gravelly, which I find very impressive when you're not moving your mouth. And she also has...
Ventriloquism is a whole, like,
yeah,
art that I don't understand.
I'm gonna totally look up this woman and link her in the thing, because she's friggin' wicked. But she also, my whole point is she also has a little monkey puppet. It's just a little monkey, and it kind of sounds like Sean Connery a little bit.
Yeah.
So it talks like, yes, I'm a very important monkey, and I need to.
I'm going to
do a magic trick for you.
Yes.
And I swear a lot also. Anyway, she's developed these characters that she assigns to strangers from the audience, who then she is improving as these characters that she has made up, but also projected onto another person who is doing things unpredictably.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just really, really interesting to see her essentially, I mean, riff on a script as characters that are unique and made up by her.
All without moving her lips.
All without moving her mouth.
Like,
yes.
That sort of amps up the challenge quite considerably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I will have to look her up. I forget her name.
Yes, absolutely. Wonderful. She will be in the show notes,
mm-hmm.
along with all the other things that we've forgotten.
Yes, we'll look it up when we get through and are reminded.
But nonetheless, I love talking in bunny voices.
Mm-hmm.
Like I talk about D&D as my excuse to do so, and it is sort of therapeutic for me to do that because it legitimizes my desire to talk in funny voices and also lets me do it for other people's entertainment. And it encourages other people to talk in funny voices.
I should do it more at D&D.
Yes.
Like, I don't do it enough in general in day-to-day life, because I...
You need a Dreg curse voice.
I feel like it's just the Tiger Cave voice.
Only one man.
I feel like that's unimaginative. You need to get, like, I don't know. Dreg curse voice should just be soccer hooligan voice.
I'm not sure that I know what that is.
Yeah,
I don't
know, just be...
Anything from, what is it, Vinnie Jones?
Yeah.
Anything from Vinnie Jones.
But just...
Or the commercial that...
This is like,
that,
Dreg, why are you British? What do you mean I'm not British?
I've always been British, don't ask questions.
Yeah, really. Anything that Bitchflower would do. Who's a pony character that we created for a fiasco game.
Yeah, yeah.
What are you saying? I'm saying punk rock! What are you saying? Literally anything else, right?
Yeah.
It'd be super fun.
Yeah, actually.
And that was how we made that canon. That's going to make for a really exciting next D&D session.
Uh-huh. Mm. That's immortalized on the internet.
The listeners don't know that you just spilled water down your front.
Thanks for clarifying.
Yeah, no problem. With that, I think we should leave it. Spend more time talking in funny voices.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good takeaway message.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's fun. Yeah. It is fun.
Makes
it is
strange.
You spend all day talking in your regular voice.
Have fun with it.
Yeah. I mean, do literally anything else. I mean, that is half the fun of singing, is that you get to do something else with your voice that isn't just like...
Oh, yeah. That's a whole thing we didn't even touch on, really.
Oh, singing. Yeah. Yeah.
Or inappropriate voices.
Yeah, that's a whole other podcast. Yeah.
Or even just the mechanics of, because we were talking about it earlier,
soft
about shifting things around and whatnot.
Next season,
yeah.
Additional funny voices podcast.
Maybe once we have a little bit more practice.
we'll have some more funny voices. So anyway, I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
I'm Kaylee.
And we're signing off.
It's not awesome. Potato. Fries.
What?
Potato.
No, that's terrible.
Fries.
No, the Baymax one's way better.